In our evening with the invocation, now Pranav, Vasudevan and Akash will come and do invocation. Please stand up. Please stand up for the invocation.
Om Sahanavavatu, Sahanau Bhunaktu, Sahaviryam Karavavahai, Tejasvinavadhitamastu, Ma Vidvishavahai. ॐ शांति 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 ही असतो मा सद्गमय तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमय मृत्योर्मा अमृतं गमय सर्वे भवन्तु सुखिनः सर्वे सन्तु निरामयाः सर्वे भद्राणि पश्यन्तु मा कश्चिद् दुःखभाग् भवेत्.
VSC is a student group rooted in spiritual idea and dedicated to Indian culture and its heritage. Thus, we are proud to have a special lecture on collapse of Aryan invasion theory and the prevalence of indigenism by Dr. Nicholas Kazanas. Swami Vivekananda says, as per the truth of these theory, there are not one word in our scripture, not one to prove that Aryan ever came from anywhere outside India. And in ancient India was included Afghanistan. We would like to begin our function by requesting our speaker to make floral offering to Swami Vivekananda. Professor Nicholas Kazanas hails from Chios, Greece and is working as a director of Omilis Meliton Cultural Institute, Athens since 1980. He has studied English literature at University College, economics and philosophy at the School of Economic Science and Sanskrit at the School of Oriental and African Studies, all in London. Also postgraduate at School of Oriental and African Studies and at Deccan College in Pune. His interest has turned towards Indian Vedic tradition and Indo-European culture since 1997. This research comprises through examination of Indo-European culture, comparing their philosophical ideas and values, their language, mythological issues and religions. He has also studied various Vedic scripture in its original Sanskrit text and has translated 10 principal Upanishads in Greek. He is in the editorial board of Adyar Library Bulletin, Chennai. He has also produced a three-year course for learning Sanskrit for Greeks. Apart from his interest in Vedic tradition and philology, the speaker is an Indologist. Now I would request Dr. Nicholas Kazanas to deliver his talk.
Well, on the map, you see the Indo-European languages. Not races, not people, but languages as they are in their historical habitat. The theory of the Aryan invasion, or as it is now called, immigration, states that at some unspecified time, the Indo-Iranians, who formed then one unit, moved from Kurgan, which is the South Russian or Pontic steppe. They moved down via the Caucasus Mountains through Iran. They stayed for a period somewhere in southeast Iran, and then the Indo-Aryans, that's the Indians, your ancestors, move away from there and came and inhabited Sapta Sindhu, the land of the seven rivers in northwest India and what is today India and Pakistan. And there you have, in fact, the languages and the main idea about the Aryan invasion theory. This happened around about 1700 or 1500. Now, any sensible person will ask, how was the Sapta Sindhu Aryanized, Sanskritized? Because the theory changed after 1995 and became the Aryan immigration theory. And moreover, in the West, they say that this immigration happened over a long period of time, several years, perhaps 200 years, with small waves of Aryans coming into that area, which we call Sapta Sindhu. Now, around about 3700, the Harappan culture was beginning to arise in that area, in Saraswati and the Indus valleys. And by 3000, it began to develop quite considerably, and it reaches its mature state around about 2700, 2800, 2600 BCE. Now, how could very small waves of people, 200, 100, 300, small waves that left no archaeological traces whatsoever, how could they Aryanize that area? That area is as large as France and Germany put together. So that's the very, very first question that needs to be answered by those who hold this theory. Himalayas are called Himavat. Now, Himavat is a perfectly Sanskrit word. Hima means cold or snow, and vat is that which possesses cold or snow. Saraswati is a perfectly Sanskritized name. Saraswati, the river that has got saras, which means currents or eddies and that sort of thing. Purushni is another Sanskrit name. Drishadvati is another Sanskrit name. The names of the people that are mentioned in the Rig Veda are perfectly Sanskrit. Vishwamitra, the friend of all. Vasishta, and so on and so forth. Bharadvaja, and so on. So how was Sanskrit spread all over that area? There was no Ministry of Education. There were no mass media. So how did this happen? These are questions that are not answered by the AIT. They just talk glibly about it, they slide over it, they pass it on from one generation to another, but they never explain these things. And unfortunately, students are not sufficiently acute to question them and say, how does this happen? Lord Colin Renfrew, who was an archaeologist, said that the notion comes rather from a historical assumption about the coming of the Indo-Europeans who spread into Europe. Therefore, the Indo-Europeans spread into India also. Then Edmund Leach, a great anthropologist, provost of King's College at Cambridge, said, because of their commitment to a unilateral segmented history of language development that needed to be mapped onto the ground, the philologists took it for granted that Proto-Indo-Iranian was a language that originated outside India and Iran, in Kurgan. From this we derived the myth of the Aryan invasion. These are Western scholars, but they are not linguists. One is an anthropologist, the other is an archaeologist. It's linguists that have concocted this idea, paying no heed to what anthropologists say, no heed to what archaeologists say. In fact, they pay no heed even to linguistics themselves, as I shall show you shortly. Now, the arguments supporting the AIT now are, one, can I have the next one, please? Iranian is older than Vedic. Avestan, the old Persian language, is older than Vedic. Then there was palatalization. Palatalization is showing at the end Latin que, Greek kai te, Vedic becomes cha. And this applies wherever you find qu in Latin or Greek, you find a corresponding cha in Sanskrit. This was called palatalization. It is shared with Slavonic languages and Baltic languages. I hope, I don't want to baffle you, I mean, one has to touch on these linguistic facts. Then the third argument is that Vedic is a mixture of Munda and Dravidian with Indo-Aryan. But that doesn't say anything about an invasion. The fact that Sanskrit has got some Munda or Dravidian words in it, if it has, it's not proven, but assume that it does so. It doesn't give you any date, and it certainly doesn't give you an invasion. Then there are isoglosses. I shall come to isoglosses later and explain what they are. But briefly now, we can say that in palatalization, an isogloss is a distinctive feature that joins together a group of languages or a group of dialects. As I said, palatalization is shared by Sanskrit, by Slavonic, and by the Baltic languages. Greek, Latin, German does not have palatalization. So one group is put apart against the others. Isoglosses differentiate between languages. Also, ma, me. Vedic has for prohibitions ma. Greek has me. Old Iranian has also ma. Armenian has mi. But Germanic has na. Slavic has na. Celtic has na. So again, we have an isogloss that separates different languages. The other great argument is horses and chariots. There are not enough horse remains in Harappan cities, the linguists say. Therefore, since the Aryans brought horses, horses should appear afterwards. That's why we have very few horse remains in Harappan cities. Then chariots also are not there. Chariots were invented round about 1800 or 1900 BCE, some at Andronovo and some at Egypt. Now, all this is utter and absolute nonsense. They don't have a leg to stand on, as I shall demonstrate shortly. Next one, please. Now, the Aryan immigration theory is supposed to be a linguistic one. It isn't. It did not start like that, and it had nothing to do with Aryans. Before, in the beginning of the 18th century, some Frenchmen and some English scholars tried to explain the peculiar caste system which they found in India. How does this come about? Now, if they looked at their own history, medieval history, they would have seen that there were castes in Europe as well, equally hereditary, not as pronounced, not as institutionalized as they are in India, but they were there. Anyway, they wanted an explanation. So what did they come up with? They came up with a sociological theory that the Egyptians invaded Saptasindhu and established themselves there. And the Egyptian priesthood became the Brahmanas. The Egyptian warriors became the Kshatriyas. And the native population became the Vaishyas and the Shudras. This, some thought it was not the Egyptians, it was the Sumerians. Even at that time, they couldn't agree between them. But anyway, well, there are the, I won't bother you with all these names, but I'll come to Max Müller, who actually introduced the linguistic element. However, neither linguistic data provide evidence for an invasion or a date of 1700, nor horses and chariots. Let's deal with horses first. Now, if the Aryans came in and brought horses, then after 1500, we should have masses of horse finds all over Saptasindhu. In fact, there is none. There are no significant archaeological finds of horse remains until these first centuries of the new current era, after Christ, in other words. Do you follow? There is no significant increase of horse remains anywhere. So how... Next one. Now, chariot translates the word ratha. Now, as you see, ratha is made from the dhatu r, which gives you the stem ra, plus the termination ta, and you've got other terminations, artha, ukta, gata, and so on. So ratha means a goer. It's a cart. It's something that moves on wheels. It has nothing to do with chariots as you see them in films in ancient Egypt or in ancient Rome or in ancient Greece. But the heritage of classical education made scholars in the 19th century translate the word ratha as chariot. In fact, anybody who knows Sanskrit and has studied MacDonald's Vedic reader will notice that MacDonald in his Vedic reader does not translate ratha not once as chariot. He always uses the word car. He was a sensible scholar. Now, the rathas are described as made of native timber. There they are. They are described as being prithu. Now, a war chariot is not prithu. It's a narrow box, big enough only to hold the charioteer and the warrior with his spear and his bow and arrows. That's all. So there were two places. But what do we find? The Vedic chariot is described as three vandura, three spaces. And there is one ashtavandura, eight spaces. It's really a minibus. It carries a lot of people. It has nothing to do with war chariots at all. And when one reads the Rig Veda, one finds that chariots are drawn mostly by oxen. The one realistic description of a chariot race, as they call it, is Mudgala and Mudgalani in the 10th mandala of the Rig Veda. Their cart is drawn by a bull. Sometimes, very rarely, it's drawn by horses, and sometimes by birds. The Ashwin chariot in the sky is drawn by birds, and sometimes by antelopes. So it has nothing to do with war chariots as are known in the West. Now, horses and chariots are really red herrings. So you find, you read the books talking about horses and chariots, you know the writer doesn't really know what he's talking about. Can we have the next one? Now, the next one is a spoked wheel. For a long time, Western mainstreamers were shouting out, there are no spoked wheels in Saptasindhu, in the Harappan culture. But in fact, they discovered spoked wheels, first of all, on the seal from Kalibangan, and that they were identified as spoked wheels by Parpola, a Finnish scholar and archaeologist, who was an invasionist, in fact. And then they were found these wheels in Kalibangan and Rakigarhi, which is a very common practice to form out of terracotta a wheel and then paint the spokes on it. They found them up in Romania, as far as Romania. So it's not just an Indian feature. Next one, please. How did this extraordinary chronology of 1500 or 1700 arise? Well, it's Max Müller again. He said, 12 to 1,000 Rigveda, 1,000 to 800 Atharva and Yajus, 800 to 600 the Brahmanas, Sutras, and so on down to 200 BCE. Very neat, you see. Every 200 years, we've got something else. Now, it would have taken alone Shatapatha Brahmana, which is vast, 200 years to write. Just one Brahmana, let alone dozens of Brahmanas. How did this arise? Well, Max Müller read Katha Saritsagara. You know, this is a lovely, the ocean of stories. And among them, there is a ghost story. And there is a chap in that ghost story called Katyayana. So Max Müller, this Katyayana lived during the reign of a particular king. So Max Müller thought, this is Katyayana who wrote the sutras, the Sharauta Sutras. So this king lived then, so that's Katyayana, 200 BCE. So he worked backwards. Let's give 400 years for the sutras, 200 years for the Brahmanas, the Upanishads, and so on and so forth. And he arrived at the date, miraculously, 1500. That's how it did, based on one ghost story. Now, how many people know this? Well, I can tell you, almost nobody, because they don't read what Max Müller wrote. They just repeat this Aryan invasion theory quite mechanically, like monkeys, and they don't know what they're saying. There was another factor, the date of creation of the universe. When Max Müller was writing, in the 1850s, Dyer's geological Dyer's geological studies had not yet gained currency, which he presented vast tracts of time. In Max Müller's day, and he was a devout Christian, they believed Bishop Ashers, an Irish archbishop, who said that, having calculated the names of the great prophets in the Old Testament, that the creation began at 4004 BCE. He gave the exact date. So, in fact, any major change in ancient history had to fall within that bracket. So 1500, 1700 seemed reasonable. If we went much before that, it would have been difficult because we would get involved with Jews and so on. So this is really how this structure was built on two fictions. Two entire fictions. And, you know, serious, mature, responsible scholars actually swallowed all this nonsense. I did too. For 18 years, I taught this theory. But I never bothered to read proto-history of India. It was only when I started reading archaeologists and historians that I began to realize that something was wrong. Next one, please. Now, this is the linguists. Please read it so that I don't get tired and my mouth gets dry. Well, there you have it. The article by George Dales in the Scientific American revolutionized Indology. There was no invasion. So the linguistic arrogance of these linguists was shown to be just that. Now, observe that Emenor talks about a linguistic doctrine. He talks about arguments. He does not talk about evidence, facts, data. And he has the arrogance to say the traditional Hindu ignorance of this invasion. Now, who was ignorant? The Hindu tradition or he himself? And the same, of course, with Barrow. Now, he was a great Sanskritist, Barrow, there's no doubt about it, but he was an awful historian. People, linguists, just linguists, not historians. A. Basham, who wrote The Wonder That Was India, you know the book, you've heard of the book. Now, he immediately, after Dales, changed his views, immediately. Because he was a historian, and he recognized historical facts. He was not, he knew Sanskrit, of course, but he was not a linguist. He didn't have linguistic training. But linguists persisted with their invasion until 1995. A book by Wynne from Columbia in New York, I can't remember the title, but he went on talking about invasion and conquest and enslaving the local population and all the rest of the rubbish. Next one, please. Now, you all know of the Rig Veda, even though you may have not read it. You've heard of it, yes? Yes. So I don't need to tell you what it is. The Rig Veda consists of 10 mandala, 1,028 hymns. It's a fairly thick book. But in all this book, you will not find these things. You will not find those words that I say, the words. You will not find iconography. You will not find perforated jars. You will not find mention of ruins or abandoned towns. And you will not find mention of fixed altars or hearths. So, what does that tell us? Now, all these features are in the Harappan civilization, in the mature Harappan civilization. The most important of the lot is the Ishtaka. The others are all equally important, but Ishtaka is really setting a limit. Because Ishtakas, bricks for building, started being used around about 3,500, 3,700. Before that, it was mud and stone and wood, just as in the Rig Veda. You find mention of Ishtakas in Yajurveda and in the Brahmanas. They describe altars in different shapes built with Ishtakas. Urbanization is wholly absent in the Rig Veda. There is, of course, Pur. But Pur in the Rig Veda never means a city or a fortress, as is usually translated. Never, not once. It means an internal, supernatural, occult defense. And you have only gods creating and destroying these pools. Well, I will not enumerate all of them because it would take us a long time, but you can take my word for it. I'm sure there's Professor Dash here who will back me up on this, that these words are not in Rig Veda. You don't find Karpasa, which is cotton. You don't find Rajata except once, and it doesn't mean silver, it means bright white. You don't find Vrihi, and you don't find Godhuma, wheat. You don't find Lekha or Lipi for writing, and you certainly don't find the rest of them. There is the word Armaka, that's true. It's often translated as ruins, but if you read that hymn 133, you'll find that it does not refer to ruins. It refers to a desolate area, a countryside, where there are sorcerers, magicians, demonic spirits, and ghouls, and that sort of thing. There is no mention of stone slabs, there is no mention of rafters, there is no mention of bricks or anything to suggest fallen houses.
Could you please repeat that comment on the
pur? Pur, what it means? It means an internal, supernatural, divine, occult defense. I've written a paper, a very long paper, and I examine many, many instances and show that that's exactly what it is. And it takes a god to destroy it. Next one, please. Well, there you have the perforated pots. There's no mention of that in the Rig Veda, but there's plenty of it in Shatapada Brahmana. Can we move on, please? Now, as you know, some Brahmanas comment on the Rig Veda. The Rig Veda refers very sparsely to various events, historical events, mythological events, we don't know. But we don't really know what's going on. And Brahmanas come along later and give us the story. So you've got the story of Shunashepa, which is mentioned in two or three verses only in the Rig Veda, but Aitareya Brahmana gives you the whole story, how the father offered his son a sacrifice, but the son, Shunashepa, gained the favor of the god Agni and was spared by god Varuna, and so on. Then you have the Pururavas and Urvashi, that beautiful hymn, a dialogue between the king Pururavas and the beautiful Apsaras Urvashi. But again, we don't know what the background is, we don't know what the plot of the story is, but Shatapatha Brahmana comes along and tells us the story, and later on, Kalidasa wrote his magnificent play, Vikramorvashiyam. Then there are many stories in the Rig Veda that we know absolutely nothing about. There was, for instance, the story of Buju. He's mentioned as being lost at sea, and the Ashwins come along with their chariot. They pick him up. You see, I've grown used to using the word chariot myself. With their car, they pick him up and drive him to dry land. What's the date of the Brahmanas? Now, why would the Brahmanas feel the need to fill in all these stories? Well, there's only one reason, really, you do that. You start writing down something when you feel that it's being lost. So by the time of the Brahmanas, these stories were lost. That's why you don't have anything about Buju. But the other stories, something remained, and the Brahmanas preserved it. Now, when is the date of the Brahmanas? Well, various calculations have been done. Narahari Achar, the professor of astrophysics in Memphis, United States, places them around about 3,000. There was another scholar, Raghavan, 1969, yeah. He had also come to the same conclusion. Subhash Kak also, he's made some calculations. He's another scientist, an Indian scientist in the United States. I think he's in Oklahoma now, I think. He used to be in Baton Rouge. He's Oklahoma, yes? Yes. Yeah. He also came to the conclusion 2900 BCE. So the Rig Veda must be a lot earlier than, say, 3000. Let's look at the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. Next one, please. Now, the main teaching of the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, as with other Upanishads, is that I am Atma Brahma. This self of man is the same as the Brahman, the absolute, the self of the universe. But it is known that there was an Upanishadam Purusham teaching. I ask about the Upanishadic person. That's in 3.9.26 in Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. So there was a long tradition. The Brihadaranyaka appears as a unified Upanishad, but in fact, after book 2, there is a list of teachers. After book 4, there is another list of teachers. And after book 6, there is another list of teachers, which suggests that there were three different traditions that were joined up and formed the unified Upanishad that we know today. So let's take one list of 60 teachers, give each teacher an average of 15 years, although 20 or 30 might be more correct, more realistic. Now, if we multiply 60 by 15, it gives us 900. Now, the Upanishads, the early Upanishads, like Brihadaranyaka, is placed in the 6th century by mainstream Western scholarship. So give it a date, 550, plus 900, which gives us the tradition behind that, we get 1,450 years. Let's say it's not 1,450 years, let's say it's 1,200 years, okay? Now, the Rig Veda is supposed to be written at 1,200 years. Not one of the rishis in the Rig Veda is the same as the rishis in the list of the Brihadaranya. Not one of them. Moreover, in the Rig Veda, we do not find the traditional teaching that we find in the Upanishad. I am Atma Brahma, or Aham Brahmasmi. We do not find it in the Rig Veda. We found it formulated differently in some of the hymns, but we do not find this particular Upanishadic formulation. So how come, if they coincide, if the Rig Veda is 1200 and the tradition of the Upanishad, let's say, begins at around that date, why is it not found? Why is there no coincidence between them? But there isn't. But you find the Upanishadic teaching in the Atharva Veda. Atharva Veda, some hymns begin to talk about the Atma Brahma doctrine. So, the Rig Veda must be a lot older than the Brihadaranyaka if 60 teachers cannot be found, one of them, in the Rig Veda. Next one, please. We come to paleoastronomy as further evidence. In 1969, Raghavan calculated that many astronomical references in Mahabharata converge in the year 3067. This was confirmed with computer and planetarium by astrophysicist Narahari Achar first time in 2003. I think, in fact, it was Dr. Kalyanaraman who asked him to do that. Isn't that so? That's right. He asked him, just try it and see what you find. And he did, and he found the same year, 3067. Now, true enough, there are some doubts. Iyengar, another physicist, another great scientist down in Bangalore, has slightly different views, questions this date, but for the moment, there isn't really any significant reason to doubt Acha. So if Mahabharata begins at around about 3000, then how much older must be the Rig Veda, whose language is significantly older, very, very different? Next one, please. And we come now to River Saraswati. Saraswati is mentioned in all the books of the Rig Veda as a great river, nourishing the five tribes of the Aryans, the Anus, the Turvasas, the Druhyus, the Purus, and the Yadus. And it's called in book 2, Nadittama, Ambitama, Devitama, greatest river, best mother, best goddess. In book, in Mandala 6, in 52, it is said that Saraswati is swollen, is made large, pinvamana, sindubhi, by many rivers. Because lots of rivers were coming down from the Himalayas, falling into the Saraswati, and the Saraswati was flowing all the way down to the sea, an enormous river. It is calculated that at one or two places, one place, its width was 14 kilometers. Can you imagine that? And 795 says, it flows clear, Giribhya a Samudrat, from the mountains to the ocean. Here, Samudra cannot possibly mean confluence or terminal lake or a gathering place of water on the Himalayas. 796 too, it is said that the Purus inhabit its two bushy banks. Then in the 10th mandala, still it is called a great river nourishing the tribes, and there is a hymn praying to Saraswati to continue to sustain the good fortune of the Vedic tribes. How old is Saraswati? Now, Michel Danino, an archaeologist, a French archaeologist who lives in India and in fact has become an Indian subject now, he's an Indian civilian, has written recently, last year, a splendid book gathering up all the evidence about Saraswati up until now. It's called The Lost River. I have no royalties, I'm not pushing it. It's an excellent book. Now, can we have the next one, please? Therein, you will find that in the very latest research, Puratattva, Sharma and other scientists show that Saraswati flows down to the sea. Now, these scholars say that this happened before 3600. I should have added there Bridget Olchin. She's another British archaeologist and expert on the Harappan civilization. That's the only time, 3600, that the river could have flowed down to the sea. After that time, it begins to dry up, and it becomes completely dried up in 1900. So if the Rig Veda is praising Saraswati as a great river swollen by many other rivers flowing down to the ocean, it must, these, at least these hymns, must have been composed before 3600. Wouldn't you say? Say yes, yes. Come on. It's not difficult. Now, the name Saraswati, Saras, means she who has swirls, ponds, currents. Now, the dhatu sr is given in the dhatu patha as gatau, flowing, leaping, rushing. Now, you find the same dhatu is cognate in Latin as sal, in Greek as hyal or hal, and in Tocharian, another Indo-European language, as sal, leap. Now, the dhatu sr gives lots of, it gives the verb sisarti or sarate, and also sara, sara, sarayu, saranyu, sarit, sara, and so on. Now, mainstream Indo-European scholars say, claim that the Aryans came into Saptasindhu, saw this beautiful river, and gave it the name Saraswati in memory of Harakhvaiti, which was in Iran. Now, the twisted thinking here is beyond belief. Observe this. The word Harakh stands alone in Avesta. There is no other word related to that word. The word for lake, the corresponding of Saras, is Vairi. Do I give it there? Yes, Vairi. Harakh, nobody knows what it means. There is nothing in Avestan to suggest anything about Harakh. We say Harakhvaiti means perhaps a river with lakes or a river with swirls and so on, because we take it from Sanskrit. Now, how is it possible? Follow my thinking, please. You have Avestan with Harakhvaiti. Now, the word Harakh has no dhatu, has no other relatives in the language. You come to Saptasindhu, suddenly Saras has a dhatu, has many relatives. Not only that, but it connects with other Indo-European languages. Now, how were the Indo-Aryans capable of inventing all this stuff? Well, they weren't. What happened is the opposite. The Iranians moved out of Saraswati, out of Saptasindhu, into Iran, and took the memory of Saraswati with them, but lost the rest of it. Do you follow? Good. There is another aspect. Observe this. Iranian does not have the original Indo-European sa sound. It has in its place ha. Soma, in the drink that the gods and the Vedic people drank, becomes in Avestan haoma. Asura becomes Ahura, Ha. You follow? So, the Indo-Aryans move away from Iran, they come into Saptasindhu, they retain the original Sa sound, but mysteriously the Avestan people lose the Sa and they make it into Ha. Now, how is this possible? The further you travel along, the more losses you are going to have. And the more steadfast you remain in one place, the greater the chance is that you will preserve the heritage. If you are moving, you don't have time to teach the children properly. If you stay put, then you've got time to teach the children properly and continue the tradition. Next one, please. Now, I'm sorry, I'm going to be very technical, linguistically here. Please forgive me. If you don't understand, it doesn't matter. What I'm trying to prove is that Vedic is much older than Avestan. You see, in Avestan, the A, the original Indo-European A, becomes A, E, E, O. Now, Vedic has Naram. Avestan has Nar-am. Do you follow? The original S, as I said, became Ha. The voiced aspirates like Dha become Da in Avestan. So the verb Dha, Da-dhati, Dhana, and so on, becomes in Avestan Da. And therefore, it becomes indistinguishable from the verb Da, which means I give. Das means I play. Da, I give, but in Avestan, both are da. But the most significant part of the lot is that periphrastic perfect. Now, shall I go on with periphrastic perfect? Do you know, have any idea what periphrastic perfect is? Please, there are some linguists down there. Now, in Vedic, periphrastic perfect, we use it all the time in English. I have done. Have and done is periphrastic perfect. You use an auxiliary verb to indicate past tense. I did is an aorist. It's past, but it has no auxiliary. I have done has an auxiliary, and therefore it's called periphrastic. Okay? Now, in Vedic, you had the accusative feminine, gamayam, chakara, or chakre. Then in the Brahmanas, you had as and bhu. So you have a new periphrastic perfect. A new verb was used as an auxiliary. What happens in Avestan? Avestan has a periphrastic perfect with the feminine, again, accusative, but with the verb to be, ah, exactly as the Brahmanas, as. What does this suggest? Now, to any trained linguist or historian who's got his wits about him, this suggests that the Iranians split from the Indo-Aryans when us began to be used. They forgot about Cree and they used us. If the Indo-Aryans had left Iran, then the first periphrastic perfect, the auxiliary verb in the periphrastic perfect, the first one would have been us. Gamayam asa, not gamayam chakre. And then they would have developed the periphrastic perfect with the auxiliary kri. Okay? You follow? Good. Well, I won't go any further. Next one, please. I will sum up the isoglosses because, again, this is highly technical and I know most of you are scientists and don't really know much about linguistics, and I don't blame you. I don't want to know much about linguistics either. But according to the AIT, beginning from the Kurgan, people spread out and they carried the language, and the language got developed differently. But you have isoglosses that are shared between Tocharian, Italic, and Celtic. This is the so-called the Ra marker for the medial passive perfect. Forgive me. Even I don't know what it means. Now, how is it possible, observe it, that Tocharian, which is far east, and Celtic, which is far west, retained the same isogloss, but Sapta Sindhu, Indic, Sanskrit, did not retain it. Iranian did not retain it. How is this possible? It's not possible. This means that Tocharian, Germanic, Slavic, Albanian, Greek, were together, they developed this isogloss to the exclusion of Iranian and Indic. But where would they have been together to the exclusion of Sanskrit? If you move from the Kurgan down, you come into the Black Sea and drown. So they couldn't possibly go south. If they went up north, that means that Hittite would have to double back and come into Anatolia. Also, Greek would have to double back. If they went eastwards, they would fall into the Caspian Sea, or if they didn't fall into the Caspian Sea, that meant that the Germans and the Italians moved westwards, they doubled back again. If they moved to the west, that means that the Tocharian and the Armenians moved eastwards. So it doesn't really make much sense. This applies to a lot more isoglosses. But if you start from Bactria, the Tocharians move up, and so you dismiss them, and that's that. You don't have to bother with them again. Then the others move further on, and that's okay. And Vedic did not preserve this. It did, actually, in a small measure, but there is no problem. So even isoglosses, a perfectly linguistic matter, goes against the linguists who propose the Aryan invasion theory. I have written a very long paper. It will get published very shortly. And if you scientists are interested, I'll send you a copy so you can read it, showing it in very great detail. Next one, please. Now, this is a scholar in New York. Now, please read what he writes. After he saw my papers, he wrote to me, and we are good friends and correspond now. This is quite independently of me. I didn't know him when he was writing these things. But he wrote to me afterwards, and that's how we got to know one another. And I show that, in fact, Vedic is, in fact, much, much older than the Mesopotamian religion. So again, we arrive, the Mesopotamians begin to rise into history around about 3000. Next one, please. Mathematics. Now, this will please you all. In fact, it would be very nice if some of you actually looked at the Shulba Sutras and see if you agree with Seidenberg. Seidenberg he's dead now. He was a great American mathematician and a historian of science, and he published two articles, one in 1962 and one in 1979, which we'll see, is in 1978, which we shall see shortly. Now, what he says is that Shulba Sutras, or mathematics like Shulba Sutras, are earlier than Babylonian. Babylonian mathematics come into history around about 1700. Greek mathematics come a lot later, but Babylonian mathematics must derive from Shulba Sutras. Shulba Sutras cannot derive from Babylonian mathematics. Next one. Now, Shulba Sutras talk about the construction of altars. Now, altars we find in mature Harappan, using the measurements laid down in the Shulba Sutras. Shulba Sutras were written by Baudhayana, Katyayana, in the Sharauta Sutras, which form the larger body of Vedanga called Kalpa. Okay? All right? You've read that? Fine. Next one, please. Now we come to something that nobody can argue against, DNA. Genetics. Anthropological studies, actually Kazanas, where he mentions me, Kazanas cites an anthropologist, Gregory Kennedy, from the United States. Now, he's done the studies, and he claims that there can't have been any change in the features of the Harappan people after 4,500. There is none, no change. But genetic studies are, in fact, much more firm, and they tell us that there was no significant flow of genes into India between 10,000 BCE and 600 BCE. 600 BCE, in the 6th century, the Persians began to come down and they conquered parts of ancient India. So, yes, from that period onward, they can trace the influx of foreign genes, but not between 600 and 10,000. On the contrary, Oppenheimer, 2003, claims that round about 50 or 40,000 years, people having moved out of Africa into Central Asia, they began to move, perhaps, he says, from Kashmir and Saptasindhu into the Northwest and Europe. So the flow is the other way around, according to all these geneticists. But observe what particularly Stephen Oppenheimer, who is an Oxford geneticist, says. Any theory of a male invasion of India is undermined by the data. You cannot have a theory of invasion or immigration into India from Northwest because the data do not support it. From 2003 onwards, these data are solid, they have not been disproved, and later studies like Sahu 2006 in the Scientific American, or is it the Genetic Journal of the United States, show this. Next one, please. Well, here you have Leach, Edmund Leach, the provost of King's College. He puts his finger right on the soft spot. Indo-European scholars should have scrapped all their historical reconstructions and started again from scratch. But this is not what happened. Vested interests and academic posts were involved. He said that, saying that once archaeologists unearthed the Harappan culture, the thinking of linguists should have changed, but it didn't. Because you have now a tremendous paradox. You have an enormous, solid culture, the Harappan civilization, Indus-Sarasvati civilization, from 3000 to 1900. But it has no literature. Then, in the same place, shortly afterwards, you have, according to the mainstream theory, an enormous literature, the Vedic literature, which has no solid civilization to support it. It's an enormous paradox that no historian can swallow. Let's go further down, please. Next one, please. What have we got here? we now examine the literary evidence in the Rig Veda itself. The Angirases say, our ancestors have always been here, they've sacrificed here. We don't remember any other place. The Vasishtas say the same thing in Book 7. In Book 5, we have Asmakasascha Surayo Vishwa Asas Tarishani. Tarishani it should be. Is it? Oh. Yes, it is. It is correct there. It's wrong here. And it explains, let our sages pervade all regions. They begin to show, there are only little snippets, that they were aware of their own civilization, they were aware of their own high level of culture, and they thought that their sages should go to other regions and civilize those people. Because around about 8,000, around about 10,000, the glaciers all over Europe and Asia began to melt, and you have about 2,000 or 3,000 years of very heavy rains. But around about the 8th millennium, it was possible to start traveling. You didn't have floods, you didn't have heavy rains, and you certainly didn't have glaciers anymore. And in Mandala 7, spread far over the earth, it is said. Mandala 10, spread far the Aryan laws. In 6.61.9, which is a hymn to Saraswati, it is said, Sano Vishwa Adidvisha Sasri Anyar Davari Atan Aheva Surya. What does this mean? She, the goddess Saraswati, made us all, that's the five tribes, as we find out in stanza 12, this is stanza 9, in stanza 12, the five tribes are mentioned. She has made us all go beyond ati dvisha, beyond enmities between us, beyond svasriyanya, beyond the other seven sister rivers. Ritavari, she, the goddess who follows Rita, the cosmic order. She spread us, Atan, as the sun, Surya, spreads the days. Aha. So, let's see that. Can we see that, please? So, there are the five tribes in Saptasindhu being spread eastwards, southwards, northwards, westwards. Can we go back? One? Thank you. Baudhayana Shrauta Sutra 1844 says there were two migrations, one eastward, the Ayava, and one western, the Amavasa. Now, the eastward we won't bother with, it's the movement eastwards towards the Gangetic plain, but we'll bother with the westward one. The Amavasas were Gandharis, which is Gandhara, slightly northwest of Saptasindhu, Parshus, the Persians, west of Saptasindhu, and Arathas. Now, Aratha, we don't know, but there is a mountain called Ararat up in the Caucasus area, you know, northern Turkey, Armenia, between the Caspian Sea and the Black Sea. There is also a tribe of people who spoke a language called Urartu. So the Arathas might well be those people. Can we have the next one, please? And then the next one. And here you have the two movements, the Ayava moving towards the Ganges, and the westward one, the Amavasa. There I show people moving towards the Tocharians, and other Indo-European branches, the Persians, Iran, Parshus, and moving northwestward. Well, There is a little bit more, but I think I'll stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor. I hope Professor would gladly answer the questions the audience would pose.
Yeah, can I say something about questions? Questions doesn't mean I don't believe you, prove my point. If you have a question, put a question so that you can get more information. I'm not going to indulge in arguments as I did in Delhi. I had some very rude people who have no idea whatsoever what it means to give a lecture and then ask questions. They started saying, I blah, 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 this, that, and the other. Now you prove this, that, and the other. This is not a lecture. This is not attending a lecture. This is polemics. Now, we are here. I hope you are civilized people. You know what the correct decorum is. You have questions, put your questions, I'll answer them. You have disagreements, put your disagreement. That's fine, you disagree. I'm not going to indulge in arguments. Okay? Thank you.
Sir, you mentioned that Iranians and possibly Europeans moved out of the Indo-Aryan area at a certain point of time.
Yes.
Now, what could be the possible reasons why they would do so, given that we had such a prosperous civilization running in the Indo-Aryan area? What could be the reasons why would they want to move out onto a, let's say, an unexplored area?
Two reasons. One reason is that some wise people moved in order to spread the Aryan laws. I mentioned that. You remember that I mentioned that? Yes. The other reason is that some were perhaps discontent. You know, Arya does not mean a race. Arya is a particular type of person who follows the Arya way of life. Now, among the, can you go back to the tribes? Yes. Among the tribes, some people did not follow the way of life of the Arya, the noble people. They moved off, they forgot some of the laws, they became an-Arya, and in fact, there were internecine wars. Some Aryan tribes fought with others. So some of them moved away, even further away, exploring new areas, settling somewhere else to be away from these objectionable areas who wouldn't have them as their brothers. That's the second reason. The third reason, there are always people who like adventure. I mean, I like adventure, that's why I come to India and meet all you people, trying to civilize you, trying to teach you your own history. Thank you. Please.
It's a little surprising that you were almost silent about the Dravidian civilization, the Dravidian
yes.
language family as a civilization and also as a sort of culture which is often contrasted with the Aryan. I mean, I'm not talking about the politics of it, but of course as a language family.
Yes.
So can
yes.
you a little bit...
What would you like me to say about that?
No, but see, you mentioned that, you know, there is a theory which says that this this Harappan civilization was originally a Dravidian civilization.
Oh, there is a theory, yes. Well, there are many
and
theories.
And you apparently seem to be countering that.
Yes, there are many, many theories, but...
There are a lot of differences between these two civilizations that as... Two families.
Which civilizations are you talking
okay,
about?
Okay, I don't use the word civilization. That's language families. Do you see that there are some visible differences between Indo-European and Dravidian?
I follow you. Now, can I speak now?
Yeah, sure.
Thank you. I will explain something. I don't know Dravidian. I don't know any Dravidian language. In fact, I don't know any modern Indian language. I don't know Hindi, I don't know Marathi, I don't know Gujarati, I don't know Bengali, I never learned them. Well, I did learn Hindi, that's true, many years ago, but I abandoned them because I did not want to spoil my Sanskrit accent. I want to keep my Sanskrit accent pure. So if I learn Hindi, I pronounce Sanskrit like Hindi. Sanskrit is not like Hindi. It's not like Bengali. So I never learned any of these languages. And I don't know any Dravidian languages at all. So I don't know. But what I have read is this. From what I have read, I have concluded that the Dravidian has nothing to do with Indo-European. Perhaps 50,000 years ago, they may have had some relationship. But now, it's very difficult to see a genetic relationship between the two. Obviously, Sanskrit has borrowed some words from Dravidian. Equally obviously, Dravidian have borrowed some words from Sanskrit. Beyond that, I don't know. What I also know is that there is a legend that Agastya came down to the south. This is a legend among the Dravidians. Came down to the south, and in fact, the Vindhya mountains bowed down so that he could pass. It is also accepted that in the Dravidian culture itself, that they have borrowed many forms from the Vedic literature. Yes, it is so. Fine. So that's all I know. Beyond that, now I know that it has become politicized and people are quarreling, and I see no reason why this should be so. I mean, what has that to do with scholarship? It has nothing to do with scholarship. I'm a foreigner, I take no sides. All I present is the fact. Dravidian, as far as I'm concerned, has nothing to do with Indo-European, a very remote relationship, but it's not like Sanskrit and Greek. They are cousins or sister languages. Sanskrit and Slavic, they are sister languages. Sanskrit and Germanic, Germanic and Greek, these are very highly, closely related languages. They have not only vocabulary, but they have also grammar, which is the same, much the same. Accusatives are the same. The aorists are the same in the verbs, and so on and so forth. Okay? Any more questions?
Yeah, sir, I have a very general question. In India, Sushir,
yes.
In India today, history is a very political subject.
What?
Sir, I said in India today,
yes.
History is a very political
yes.
subject.
Yes.
When, for example, we're talking about, say, Saraswati,
yes.
or we're getting into the technicalities or the scientific details of Saraswati,
yes.
the most respected and eminent historians in India have declared it to be pulp fiction. And unfortunately, as you definitely know, they have support from, say, the historians as far as the ones in Harvard or, say, like Mr. Witzel or all of that. My question to you is, what is your opinion about how the people who don't agree with them must actually take them on to get the truth out of it? And number two, how should in India you suggest that history as a subject must be taken forward? Subject of study in schools, especially.
Well, I find that left-wingers usually politicize these matters because the thinking is that we must destroy society and rebuild it according to Marxist, socialist, left-wing ideas. They haven't cottoned on to the simple fact yet that the socialist regime in Russia collapsed completely, as well as in all other socialist countries. It's still maintained in China, but Chinese have opened out capitalism. They're no longer a pure socialist country. Why, if they accept that there was really a Vedic people indigenous to Sapta Sindhu, then their claims about the castes, and they're trying to rouse up the castes against the present political system, would collapse. But at the moment, they've got a hold onto that. It gives them a good excuse. It's not up to me to tell you how to pursue your history. Now, to say that Witzel doesn't accept the work of archaeologists and geologists proves only that Witzel is not in his right mind. It doesn't prove that the archaeologists and the geologists are wrong, because there has been done tremendous work. I would suggest once more, read Danino's book. It brings all the facts together. Historians don't accept it. Well, who cares about what historians accept or don't accept? It's not their job to tell us whether there was a geological phenomenon called Sarasvati. This is for the geologists and for the archaeologists to tell us. So I turn to them. It's from them that I take the facts, not historians. Historians should respect what archaeologists and geologists and hydrologists speak about. They do the research. It's their job. It's not the historian's job. The historian's job is to examine the facts and then write history. Anything else?
You talked about the dating of Mahabharata.
Yes.
With the paleoastronomical dating.
Yes.
But there are two archaeological markers for Mahabharata.
Yes.
Like the Hastinapura flood and also the Dwaraka thermoluminescence dating.
Yes.
Which both bring down the date to 1500 or 1200 BCE. Whereas the paleoastronomical dating is actually ambiguous.
Yes.
Not a very hard...
I mentioned that. I did say that Acharya's dating should be re-examined. I mentioned Iyengar, who objects to that.
Yeah.
Now, both Narahari Achar and Iyengar are very close friends of mine. And I don't know what to make of them. We're going to launch a new journal on Vedic studies. And I shall be the chief editor, and I shall invite them both and other scientists to write about these things and confront one another to see where the truth lies. Okay? This gentleman here and then the other gentleman up there.
You mentioned the collapse of Aryan invasion theory. Now there's a reverse of it. There's a theory, Aryan immigration from India. Do you have anything to say?
Sorry? Aryan migration from India?
Yes, Aryan immigration from India to outside.
Well, it's going
on. There's a reverse of it. There's a theory going on for a long time. Do you have anything to say on this?
Yes, I have, yes.
From India to outside.
Yes. Well, it's happening now. I mean, there are thousands of Indians in the United States, in the United Kingdom. Yes, okay. I'll talk about it.
In the same time context of audience.
Can I have the next map, please? The last one. No, map. Next. That's it. Now, here it is. I showed it before. The blue line going up is going out of India, Persia, Central Asia. Okay? Yes, that's it. Okay, shall I give you a copy? The young man up there.
Yeah, so as you mentioned, Sanskrit is much older than Harappan civilization. So
yes.
why then the Harappan people didn't use Sanskrit? Instead, they used the Harappan language, which is not yet deciphered, as I know.
Okay. A moot point. We don't know what Harappan people, what language they used. They have some seals with very few symbols on. And it's very difficult to decipher when you have very few symbols. In Greece, I'll give you an example. I know I have my friend here, my beloved Kalyanji, and he has made an effort to decipher it, but there are many others have made efforts to decipher it. Now, in Greece, many in the last century, they discovered two different writings. The one was called Linear A, and it was a very short piece of writing, a disc with symbols on it, and the other was called Linear B. Now, some scholars examined them. Eventually, because Linear B had many, many texts, they were able to decipher it. And they found that it was a very old form of Greek, very Indo-European. Linear A still remains undeciphered. It's a disc, it's called the Phaistos disc in Crete, in the island of Crete. I have seen it with my own eyes, lovely and so on, but a mystery. Because it's very little. There isn't enough material there to bite. You follow? So it's the same with Harappa. We don't know what language they spoke. I mean, some say they spoke many languages. Possibly. Others say they spoke Dravidian. Possibly. Others say they spoke Sanskrit. Possibly. We don't know. Until we find out, we leave it at that. But Vedic is older than the Harappan civilization. The Rig Veda is older than the Harappan civilization. And I thought I demonstrated it before. It doesn't know Ishtaka, the building material of the Harappan civilization. If it was after that, or if it was contemporary, it would have mentioned at least once, as Yajurveda does, as the Brahmanas do. Do you follow? Okay.
Yeah. Sir, but...
I will allow one more question, then we must pass on to somebody else. Yes.
When we think that Sanskrit is such a quite perfect language, why did Harappans go for another language? Or is it that the Harappans used the Sanskrit in a different script?
We don't know what the Harappans spoke. How many times must I say that?
Oh yeah, I understand.
People claim that it was Dravidian. Others claim it's Sanskrit, but there is no proof. Yes.
You mentioned in one of the slides that Angirasas. And
yes. Can we go back, please?
Angirasas and
Vasishtha. No. It's not. It's further ahead.
That we are from this family. Yeah. And three. Other proof. Again, the Aryan tradition theory is that nowhere else is it mentioned that we came from somewhere else. Right? So these two are in favor of indigenous.
Yes.
But then in the last slide, you say that there was a migration out from India.
Yeah.
Last slide, people are going from India proper to Iran and so forth westwards.
Yeah.
Is there a proof for that?
Sorry?
Is there any proof for that?
What kind of proof?
Baudhayana
says so.
Like the
archaeological proof for that.
Then, if I may say so, I mean, if you're a linguist like me, if you were a linguist like me, and you did the same sort of research, you would find out that Avestan is younger than the Rig Veda, which means that there was a movement away, linguistically. Okay, now, what we need now is to see whether archaeology also can support this movement. Now, there is a man in Delhi. He promised me he'll look into it. He works in this area, Afghanistan. Okay? Thank you very much. Please, can you give the...
Can we take the archaeological excavations happened in Arkaim, A-R-K,
KHAIM. I saw a video about it. So archive in somewhere in Russia, and the temples or the Vishnu idol found in Russia. The news came a couple of years back. There was a temple excavated in Russia.
I'm sorry, I'm not aware of this. Where is this published?
I can send. I have.
Will you you kindly please?
I have.
Yes.
So. Can we say, you know, I'm able to link that, you know, they in that archive video, they were saying that these structures were there, and from here only the people would have gone to India. So yes. They were supporting the AIT. Yes. So from your slides, you know, I could say that maybe it could be other way. It could be other way. And number two, as the Vishnu idol has been found in Russia, so the civilization would have gone, like, you know, the migration would have gone from here to there, yes. And then they could have established.
Yes, absolutely. Why not? I think, you see, if for centuries, decades, two centuries, historians, archaeologists think of Aryan invasion, Aryan immigration, well, they interpret the facts like that. And anything that goes against it, they push aside. We don't look at that. But if you begin to think that perhaps it is not so, if it is as Bodhayana says, and as some of the hymns of the Rig Veda say, the people are moving westward, then let's look at archaeological facts from this angle now and see whether it is possible. So archaeologists will start doing that. I have a lot of influence with Indian archaeologists. I know lots of them, and I shall push them to look into that.
Excuse me. This side. See, in our Panchanga, we always have a...
Please hold it closer. Close.
Panchanga. Almanac. In our almanac, we start Yudhishthir Shaka. That is the era of Yudhishthir from 5,000 years back.
Excellent. I'm all for that. Yes.
And also, this Rig Veda has a Upanishadic stage as Prajnanam Brahma.
What?
You have mentioned here that Rig Veda did not have anything to connect between Atma and
Brahman.
Brahman. But in Rigvedic this thing, we have Prajnanam Brahma.
Not in Rig Veda.
Yes, in Rig Veda. There are four, this thing for each Veda, there are four statements saying
this
that...
This is Prajnanam Brahma is Brahma. In...
Prajnanam Brahma is with Rig Veda.
Not in Rig Veda, it's one of the Upanishads.
But that is what I'm telling. It is one of
what?
The Upanishads.
They are not in Rig Veda.
But there are, it is said as from Rig Veda.
Please.
Then
please.
Also there are Upanishads connected to Rig Veda.
Oh, there are Upanishads connected to Rig Veda, but these are later compilations.
And most of the Upanishads are telling about connection between Atma and...
Take your point. Thank you very much. But it is not
please,
correct.
I would like to tell you that kindly look into this.
I have looked into it. For years I'm looking into it. Now I have got Professor Dash here who will support me, and I have a lady further back who also supports me. So I suggest, perhaps with the help of Professor Dash, you can look into it. Good.
Sir, I have a very quick question.
Yes.
Your date seemed to suggest place Rig Veda somewhere around 3,500 to 4,000 BCE.
Yes.
Or earlier.
I would put Rig Veda before 4,000.
Okay. Yeah. Right around that time, there was a thriving civilization in Egypt, and there is massive archaeological evidence.
It's later.
There's some structures that are dated to earlier than. I know there is controversy around that, but the fact that people were living and in some urbanized fashion. My only question is, are there any cross references, or is it even appropriate to look for cross references?
Egyptian civilization as such begins just after 3000. There are no structures in Egypt before that. The first writing begins just before, just at about that date, but the first texts in mass are found in the pyramids from around 2400. If you examine the writings, those writings, and compare them to the Vedic writings, you will find certain common elements. I have myself written a paper comparing the two and showing these common elements. There is only one snag. Vedic people could not have borrowed from Egypt because these elements are also apparent in other Indo-European cultures. There is the sun boat. Ra, the god Ra, floats in his sun boat up in the sky. Okay, now Bhushan, the sun god, or an aspect of the sun god in Vedic, also has a whole armada of ships, not just one. There is a legend that the eye of Ra fell off and ran away into the desert. And Ra sent his daughter to bring it back. And she did. There is a legend in Brahmanas about the creator Prajapati losing his eye, going away, and then Ushas brings it back on a white horse. Now, to have such a legend is extraordinary. Now, who would think that the creator God's eye runs off into the desert? Now, obviously, there must be similarity. But Vedic is much older than Egyptian. I've written a book, or rather, I wrote several articles, and Aditya Prakashan in Delhi brought them together as a book. It's called Indo-Aryan Origins and Other Vedic Issues. I deal with all these matters. I deal with Mesopotamia. I deal with Aryan invasion theory extensively. I deal with Samudra. I deal with Pur, and so on. So, get a copy from the library, please, and consult it.
As we are running out of time, we'll have one last question.
One last question, right.
Sir, I would like to get to the fundamental objective of this Aryan invasion theory and then put forward this question to you. You know, from what I understand, the AIT was introduced to play around with the Indian politics at that time by the British. To that length, you know, if you look at Indian languages, they have consonants and vowels. They have A, I, E, U, and you have consonants. That's exactly how Sanskrit and Hindi, for that matter, everything else is organized. From that perspective, all Indian languages are unique from having, you know, in having consonants and vowels separated, and they combine to form words.
Well, it happens in all languages.
Yeah. So, however, with the other languages, you know, 54 letters in Sanskrit. And I would like to understand, from that perspective, would we be able to get some evidence to prove that Sanskrit and Tamil are indigenous to India? What is your view
on that? No, I don't think so. I don't think so. You can argue linguistically, but it will not be on the simple alphabet, on the Akshara Samamnaya. No, that will not prove anything. Well, I think we better stop here. We've gone a long time. I don't mind. I mean, I can stay for a long time, but I think the people who invited me here want to go and have supper, so, and they want to drag me along. So we must be practical as well. You scientists ought to know this. So I thank you very much for your patience. I hope I have not offended any sensibility. Thank you very much.
Such an enlightening talk on collapse of Aryan invasion theory and prevalence of Indianism. I'm sure we all really enjoyed it, really. discussion was so nice. Now I will request Savyasachi to present a bouquet to our speaker.
We are extremely thankful to Professor Nicholas Kazanas for delivering such an eye-opening lecture on this topic of collapse of Aryan invasion theory and the prevalence of indigenism. We in IIT Madras are extremely happy to host a lecture for during your visit to India all the way from Greece. We are extremely thankful for providing counter viewpoints which have been prevailing during the past by providing linguistic, archaeological and genetic evidences. We would also like to thank Dr. Kalyan Raman of the Saraswati Research Center, Mr. Kali Varadhan, and Mr. Ramachandran of Samskrita Bharati for helping us organize this lecture. We would like to thank the Dean Students Office, Placement Office, the PA system, and the Center for Continuing Education for the support. Finally, we'd like to thank all you all audience for attending this lecture and for your continued support to Vivekananda Study Circle.
Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi.